Good afternoon. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and on behalf of George's family, we welcome you to this celebration of the life of George Arthur Gissendaner. Times like this, we go to the scriptures, the Holy Scriptures, and we're reminded of that beautiful, beautiful verse in Psalm 116. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. And so, Father, we come to you now in the name of Jesus Christ, recognizing your presence with us through the Holy Spirit, and thanking you that we can come to you at a time like this. Family, friends who so much love George, and are so thankful for your goodness to us by placing George in our lives. And thus we're here to celebrate his life and your goodness to us through him. So be pleased, Lord, with the way we celebrate this incredible man. In the powerful name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. We've asked Doug Chun to come. Jamie and Michael felt that it might be best if they could just take in the service this afternoon. And so Doug Chun has been asked to read the psalm. He is the men's small group leader that George has been in for many years at Fremont Community Church. So Doug, come now and read the scripture for us.
Did you feel those gentle teardrops from heaven walking in today? Those are from George. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Oh, my husband would be so pleased to see you all here today. My goodness, he would be so surprised. Thank you for coming. This is George's life story as I know it. George was born April the 6th, 1933, in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He was the firstborn of two children, to Ruth and Bob Gissendaner. His brother Bobby arrived 13 months later. George liked to tell people the significance of his birthday was that it was the day Prohibition ended and 3.2 beer went on sale in the liquor stores in Pittsburgh. His father got to celebrate in a big way that day, legally. George was a happy little boy. He liked to spend time with his father in their basement, building things with his father's handcrafted tools. At a very early age, he became interested in airplanes, fascinated with them, actually, and he began drawing them. He progressed from drawings to building them out of balsa wood. This was a love he would enjoy his entire life. George attended Mount Oliver Elementary School and was a very good student. He loved school and he respected all his teachers. When he was a young teenager, he got a part-time job in a delivery store, delivering groceries and working part-time there, delivering them in his wagon. Now, the owner of the store was a tough Southerner, and he insisted that George would leave those groceries only if the customer had cash to pay. This was really a tough job for George because he was so shy and he just didn't want to not leave those groceries for the people. His high school years were spent at Brentwood High School. In one of the popular hangouts was a teenage dance hall. It was called the Linden Grove. This is where he met his future wife, me. He asked me to dance, and I was thrilled to accept because he was the handsomest boy there. He's always been the handsomest one. We began to date, and shortly before my senior prom, George was drafted into the Army. After basic training, he joined the 101st Airborne Division at Fort Campbell, Kentucky. Paratroopers received an extra $50 for every jump that they made, and that was George's big incentive to earn that money. When George's two-year commitment in the Army was completed, he proposed to me, and we were married December the 9th, 1955, at Concord Presbyterian Church in Cary, which is a suburb of Pittsburgh. I was 19, he was 22. George had begun working for U.S. Steel Corporation in the mailroom before he entered the Army. He also worked a second job at a gas station and attended night school classes at Duquesne University. He now worked his way up to a management position in the traffic department of U.S. Steel. On September 26, 1957, we were blessed with our first son, Gary, the birth of our first son, Gary. He would be joined by his brother, David, 18 months later. These early years presented all the challenges of young married couples. But we were very responsible, and we worked together at being the best parents we could be. I was a stay-at-home mom, but all the moms were stay-at-home in those days in Pittsburgh. George was wonderful in helping me with the children, and he had a talent for being able to fix anything. This really came in handy since money was always in short supply. On October 5th, 1962, we were overjoyed at the arrival of our baby girl, Diane. Our family was now complete. In 1966, after 10 years of marriage, George was transferred to San Francisco with U.S. Steel. It was a bittersweet time for us as we left all our friends and family behind. We settled in San Carlos on the peninsula where we purchased our first home in California. This small home cost three times more than our home did in Pittsburgh. It was also half the house and with no land. And we were stunned. We couldn't believe it, and we felt like we had to apologize when anybody came to visit from back east. Like, what happened to these poor kids? We attended Trinity Presbyterian Church and later First Baptist Church in San Carlos. After a few years, we drifted away from our faith and stopped attending church completely. I was now working outside the home, like all the other women in California. George and I began to have marital difficulties, and ultimately we separated. During that period, tragedy struck our family, May 28, 1978, when our oldest son, Gary, had a climbing accident in Yosemite. He passed away a few days later, June 3rd. We tried to patch up our marriage, but sadly, after 30 years, we divorced. I moved to Newark, and George moved to Pleasanton. George had been forced into an early retirement from from the failing steel industry. He tried a couple of sales positions, but this was definitely not a good fit for him. He always said he just couldn't handle the rejection. The bottom line was he was simply too sweet and sensitive for the field of sales. Since he was very good at working with his hands, he decided to attend a wallpapering school in San Diego. This was an excellent choice for him, and he began his final career as a professional paper hanger. He worked for various decorators in this area. He became very involved with his model airplane club and would fly his beautiful planes almost daily. He developed wonderful, wonderful friendships with these men, and they became his closest of friends. I think of Bob and Mario and Rudy and Paul, and there are so many of you. He just absolutely loved you. In the evenings, he could be found at the Pleasanton Hotel, where he loved to dance. For 15 years, we went our separate ways, and we only saw each other at special family celebrations or an occasional holiday. Little did we know God had a much bigger plan for us. He was guiding us back together, though we were totally unaware of it. During this period, I started a business, and one of my clients had been attending a class called Bible Study Fellowship in this very church. I asked if I could join her for a meeting, and through this powerful program, I recommitted my life to Christ, September 21st, 1992. This was not some religious ritual, but a deep relationship with Jesus, my Savior, who loved me enough to go to the cross for me. I joined Fremont Community Church and began to pray for George, although reluctantly at first. After a few years, George and I began to see each other. He told me he had become discontented with his lifestyle and felt that something deep was missing. He started to attend church services with me, and our friendship began to develop and grow. In 1998, the Christmas program at Fremont Community Church particularly touched his heart. He realized that what was missing in his life was a spiritual connection. He made an appointment with Pastor Sherman Williams to inquire further as to what steps to take to fill the void that he had been feeling. During that evening, together on January 12, 1999, George made the decision to turn his life over to Christ. Now he began to see me often. We got together frequently. It was such a sweet time for us. And in October the following year, George proposed to me again, and I accepted. This came as a big surprise to our children when we announced it that Thanksgiving. We selected the same date as our first wedding, since I told him I couldn't remember two different dates. After all, we were now 65 and 68 years old. So on December the 9th, 2000, we were remarried at Fremont Community Church on what would have been our 45th wedding anniversary. The Bible verse we chose for our wedding was from Ephesians 3:20, and I quote, "Now unto him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine, according to his power that is work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." We began our new life together in Newark, but ended up moving to Pleasanton in 2002. In our condo complex, you could find George inviting the children into the garage to watch him build his model airplanes, chatting with our wonderful neighbors, or in his role as what I like to call the dumpster cop. If he saw the dumpsters were getting filled with big boxes, which really irritated him, he would go out there and break down those boxes, jump on them, and break them down. Our neighbors are really going to miss his service. Our brand new beginning brought us much joy, but also so much pain. By now we were blessed with our wonderful grandchildren, and he deeply loved each one of them and bragged about them regularly. And that was the joyful part. The sad part was that George began to have health issues and had to retire from his wallpapering business. The main cause was heart disease. He had had quadruple bypass surgery when he was 50, but now new complications were evident. He had a second surgery to replace an aortic valve, and it was a slow, very painful recovery. He went through a period of severe depression, which really broke our hearts. But he did recover, and he was sharper than ever mentally. We decided it was time to get involved in a local church in Pleasanton. The decision to leave Fremont Community Church was painful. We loved it there. But ultimately, we knew that God wanted us here at Valley Community Church. We joined VCC, and were embraced by a wonderful group of new friends. We got very involved in the church. It was right. We knew it was right. And it was such a blessing. We attended Sunday school and joined an unbelievable home group. I joined Ephesus and a women's Bible study group. And most recently, George joined a men's Bible study. And the theme of the study was called Going from Good to Great. He was so excited about this class. And on the morning of his last day, he shared with me two goals that he had made. The first was to stop feeding himself negative things in this world and become a more positive influence for me, our children, our grandchildren, his friends, and our community. He wanted to move from being a mediocre Christian and to go from good to great in God's eyes. That night, George moved into the ultimate great status as he entered the gates of heaven. I'm missing him desperately. George was always a perfect gentleman. He never failed to pull out my chair for me or open a door, ever. I will miss that. He was my fashion consultant. When I would ask, which earring, this one or this one? Which shoe, that one or that one? He would be the one to advise me. He was patient with me when I was impossible. He loved me when I was unlovable. I will miss kneeling at the foot of our bed together each night to pray, and oh, so many other ways. My husband was a simple, very simple, humble man. He did not achieve monetary heights by the world's standards, but what he reached was beyond wealth and possessions. What he left behind was priceless, the gift of his life. I am totally certain of where he is, and I know that I will join him there when God calls me home. Thank you.
For the last, we figured out between 7 and 8 months, to be the pastor for this wonderful couple. And one of the things that I'm going to miss is they really did, since they've been here, they joined everything. They've been involved in everything. But what I'll miss most is they sit right behind me on Sunday mornings. And I come sit in my little perch here on the front row, and right behind me, go to Gissendaner's. Faces just aglow, smiles as big as could be. And you can see on their faces, I can't wait to see what God's going to do today here in our church. That's a gift to a pastor. The rest of you out here from BCC, are you listening? And I've often, when we were calculating how long they've been here in our church, part of me just stops and says, that can't be true. Surely they've been here much longer than that. How can somebody that's only been around for 7 months have brought so much joy, so much happiness, so much encouragement, so much a sense of belonging in such a short time? But that's what you guys have done. And you're such an amazing blessing to all of us here at Valley Community Church. I know that you people from Fremont community know exactly what we're talking about. You've enjoyed it for a lot of years as well, and yet it's just a privilege. And whenever I come to one of these memorial services, one of the things that I almost, and I say this over and over again, when I sit and listen and to one of these services and be a part of it, and one of my great regrets is, gosh, I wish I'd just known it all those years for the whole story. Thank you for sharing that with us, and thank you for others who will share memories in a few moments. When you look at that face, and that's the face I saw every Sunday morning on the second pew right here. That big smile, that happiness to be a part of that. What gives us that sense, what allows us in a moment like this to find that kind of peace, that kind of joy? And I want to just return for a very brief few comments on the passage that was read earlier, the 23rd Psalm, which is a psalm that has brought comfort and meaning and help to people across the centuries ever since David penned it so many centuries ago. David starts out with this wonderful, wonderful opening phrase, "The Lord is my shepherd." And who would know better than David what that meant? He grew up a shepherd boy, tending his family's sheep. And by calling the Lord his shepherd, David is calling himself a sheep. And David knew what that meant. Sheep among the animal kingdom, none of them ever get a Rhodes Scholarship. They're some of the dumbest animals on the face of the earth. They're easily swayed. They're easily wander off to their own peril. And David, by calling himself a sheep, understood the fragility and the absolute neediness of being a human being. And this from a young man who had everything to commend. He was a man of poetry and would grow to be a fierce warrior, and all of the attributes that we might say, this was a man's man, this was a wonderful, accomplished human being. And David understood, though, that life and human beings are fragile and easily prone to wandering. To wander into places where danger is, where they may not anticipate what lies ahead. And what he desperately clung to his God for was, he's my shepherd. And as he unfolded that beautiful psalm and repeat these themes and others of his writings, he was just absolutely grateful that he had a heavenly Father who treated him with such care, who provided everything he needed. Whether it was the big sustenance of life, whether it was protection from danger, whether it was the need for courage to face whatever would come, David relied on that shepherd. And embedded right in the middle of that, this wonderful psalm, is this sort of haunting phrase, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." The reality is, as human beings, there's never a day that we are not in that valley. It is the nature of human existence that we walk in the valley of the shadow of death. We make jokes about it. Nothing is sure except death and taxes. It's the part of the psyche of being human that there is this thing called death that's there. We don't know how it's going to come. We don't know when it's going to come. It can be suddenly. It can be drawn out. It can be in any shape or form. It can be expected or unexpected, but it comes. And then when we come to a day like this, we collectively acknowledge together that valley of the shadow of death, because that's what's drawn us here. And then David utters the most incredible words. In spite of this reality, in spite of this danger, in spite of this reality that scares us and should put fear in our hearts, he says these words, "I will fear no evil when I walk through that path." Why? Because he's a brave warrior? Because he's a philosopher poet that can figure it all out? He says, no. I fear no evil because you're with me. The shepherd is with me. And it's your rod and your staff, those tools of the shepherd's trade that would both fend off danger or haul a sheep out of a gully that he'd fallen into, symbols of protection and care. It's the Lord's tools, the shepherd's tools. The reality of a loving father, a loving shepherd that would walk with him through every valley that he ever went through, gave him the courage to say in the face of whatever would fall, come his way, "I will fear nothing because you're with me." And so, that shepherd is what gives us the ability to go forward. The author of Hebrews in the New Testament, many, many years later, would write words like, "We have a Savior who understands us completely because he's become a human being and suffered everything that we've suffered. And he's there, and because of that, because of what he has, the experience he's entered into, because of what he's done for us on the cross, he frees us from what grips," he says, "every human being, that fear of death." And that's what our Heavenly Father, our shepherd, has done for us. And the 23rd Psalm closes with these other incredible words, "Surely goodness and mercy." Mercy there is the word, the Old Testament word for covenant love, commitment. It's a word that there, for which there is no true English equivalent, because it's too rich, it's too marvelous, it's just too wonderful. It speaks of love and covenant and mercy, all of those things wrapped up into one big idea that the God of the universe, the shepherd, is committed to me completely, absolutely. And his goodness and his mercy, they follow me all the days of my life. And he says, "And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And we know where George is. We know he's in that house of the Lord. And he's begun that foreverness of intimate relationship with his Savior, with the shepherd, our loving Heavenly Father. You know, Jesus, on the night that he was going to go to the cross, met with his disciples, an unlikely group of people that were about to have something thrust on them that they were woefully unprepared for. And Jesus, in his last words to them, was trying to prepare them for two great realities. One, that he was no longer going to be with them. And they had no idea about that. He hinted at it. He told them about it. He'd warned them about it. And they were totally oblivious to what was about to take place on that eve as they gathered for a Passover meal. But Jesus wanted to prepare them for the reality that they were going to be without him, and secondly, they were now going to be in charge of going forward with this great mission of God. And so, here we are, preparing to deal with whatever a new normal will look like without George in our lives. You don't know what that's going to look like. You don't know yet what that's going to be. But Jesus' words to his disciples ring equally encouraging to us today when he says to them, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Trust in God. Trust in me. In my Father's house are many rooms or dwelling places," a picture that simply means that God's house is big enough for all that he wanted to come. He says, "If it were not so, I would have told you I'm going there to prepare a place for you." Now, I grew up in the church, so I heard people, pastors, read this, and I have developed a rather sentimental view of this view. And to me, it meant that there was this gigantic hotel, luxury spa hotel up there in heaven, and that Jesus was going to go prepare. He's going to do turndown service and make a nice room for me and leave a mint, you you know, on the pillow, and I just gonna be this, that was my sort of childish, sentimental view. And then I came to realize when he says, I'm going to prepare a place for you, he's not talking about a turn down service at a glorious mansion. He's talking about going to a cross. I'm gonna go and prepare a place for you. I'm gonna die for you. I'm gonna offer myself so that you can enter into the Father's house forever and ever. And out of that, that means, and if I go to do that, I'm going to come and bring you to where I am, that you may be there forever. And in the same words that David realized way back in the 23rd Psalm, that are coming out of Jesus' mouth now, we have eternal hope because of who our God is and because of what Christ has done. And his disciples still confused about what all this meant. And finally, Jesus said, let me just cut through it all again. Here's the answer. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father but through me. But the wonderful flip of that is so gloriously true. But everyone who comes to me comes to the Father. And I would say to you all who are here today, family, friends, neighbors, acquaintances of whatever path your life intersected with George. George found that hope in Christ. He found that new life in Jesus. He found that way into the fellowship with the Father and now into the very presence of God himself. And nothing would honor him or encourage him more than for you to have that same faith, that same freedom, that same knowledge that Jesus is the way into God's eternal glory. And so as we go forward from this day, we go with our memories, we go with our sorrows, we go with our joys, that my prayer for all of us, for all of you as closest family, that you will enter into this next season with hope and joy because your shepherd's with you. And Jesus is the way to the Father's house. He's going to walk there with you as well. Find your courage. Find your hope. Not in ourselves, not in what we can muster up, but in the reality of who Jesus is, what he's done for us, and how he'll walk with us. Well, let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, our Shepherd, it is absolutely true that we have everything we need. And above all else, we have you to guide, protect, and to walk with us this day to this valley of the shadow of death. And we will not fear, even though we hurt, because you are with us. And we thank you that, Jesus, you have gone and prepared the way for us on that cross, and you are calling us home, and that one day we will all be there together with you because of what you've done. And I pray for this dear family, Joni, and for Diane, and for David, and for these precious grandchildren, and for the rest of the family and friends, that you would bring your healing hope to each and every life. We praise you and thank you for your great gift. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Pastor Danny, appreciate that very much. You'll notice in the program folder that we're moving into a time of memories. And before we open up the mic to others, I thought I would like to just give a few of my memories as well. I, like Pastor Danny, when I think of George, I picture his smile. It was a warm and welcoming expression that immediately put me at ease whenever I was in his presence. No condescension, no judgment, just a warm acceptance on his comments. When I think of my friend George, I also think of the word gentleman. He had class. He was respectful. He was respectable. There was a sense that George knew how to handle each situation appropriately. Not only was he a gentleman, but he was a gentle man. Soft-spoken, man of few words for the most part. I fondly remember our exchanges each Sunday morning at Fremont Community Church as we would greet each other. Although his words, yes, were few, I was encouraged by the love and acceptance that I felt from him. Joan spoke of the change in George after he committed his life to Jesus in January of 1999, 15 years ago. I remember well that evening when he walked into my office there at FCC. He was aware there was something missing, some missing piece in his life. His soul was hungry. We prayed. George prayed. And when he left the church campus that evening, it was clear that he had a new purpose, a focus that was the sure hope of his future. Don't you love those words? Sure hope. The sure hope of his future, that he took hold of the mystery and the beauty of a relationship with Jesus Christ. It was clear to him that even when all the good he had done was there in his life, it was clear to him that even then, and not only how good a man he was, but also how important it was to Joan that he would become a Christian. We talked about that. So this has got to be about you and Jesus, not you and Joan for Jesus, or you and Jesus for Joan. He said, no, I need the grace of Christ to save me from my sin. And he came to the cross that night. So thankful that he allowed me to be the one to witness that decision. Wow. And then 11 months later, like has been said, to stand with George at the front of the pavilion at FCC and watch his bride come down the aisle to remarry on what would have been their 45th wedding anniversary. I mean, I can honestly say that's one of the highlights of me being a pastor. I mean, how often does that happen? I don't know, does that rank as a miracle? Yes. I think so. Yeah. I'll go for that, thank you. Evening, I'll never forget. These last 15 years have had mountains and valleys, the ebb and flow of life. But through it all, there has been a peace that even in the midst of pain and questions and health issues, there was the constant factor that George and Joan were united spiritually. They faced each circumstance with faith and even joy that the God who had brought them back together would carry them through even the most difficult times. It's an inspiration. I will miss George's kind, understated presence in my life. All of us. We'll miss him, but someday in the not too distant future, I will see that smile again. I can only say, hey, Pastor, welcome home. And until then, I trust completely in God who showed up in George's life and accomplished more than we could ever ask or imagine. And Joni, there is still more for you to do. Even as Marty and I grieve greatly with you, we look forward to seeing how this next season of your life will unfold with great riches. Well, all right. Now we're getting close to you having an opportunity to give a memory of George, and I'm going to get the other mic. And what we would like to do is to start with Diane and David and Luca, and then we'll open it up to the rest of the family and make the friends. Is that okay? All right, so Diane, why don't you come first, and I'll hold this mic for you, and you can make a speech. Do you want to go up there and do it up there?
Sure.
My dad was a wonderful man, a true gentleman, and a perfect example of a great father. He showed me what a man is supposed to be like. He was firm yet kind, strong yet gentle, serious yet silly. I always knew I was safe and secure when I was with my dad. I don't recall us ever having to call a repairman for anything. My dad could fix anything in the world with epoxy glue and an X-Acto knife. His hands repaired hair dryers, curling irons, toasters, washing machines, all plumbing and electrical needs, and countless pieces of jewelry. He would hand you back your repaired item, and he would say, "These are nice." This was a reference to an umbrella-selling street vendor in San Francisco who my dad used to walk by every night on his way to the train station. This phrase was used many, many times over the years, and every time my dad would say, "These are nice," he would tell you about that umbrella salesman and vouch for his good product. It seemed to me that my dad could do anything and everything. He would entertain my friends by wiggling his eyeballs for them, an odd trick, and a story he loved to tell. My friends would say, "Wiggle your eyes, Mr. Gissendaner," and they would squeal with delight. My dad could barbecue 3 different types of meat at the same time, and they would all come out perfect. That's a task. He was the world's greatest at removing a splinter from your finger, a task that resembled crude surgery, but he performed it with great skill, and usually it was painless. My dad did the yard work, he changed the oil in the cars, he took the train to work in San Francisco every day, and always made it home for dinner with his family by 6 o'clock. I didn't realize it at the time, but he was instilling important habits and values that I would apply to my own family years later. When I was a little girl, my dad's pet name for me was Lizzie Bullets. I don't know who she really was because she didn't come up when I Googled her, but I love that nickname. I have fond childhood memories of weekend traditions, which included trips to J&M Hobby House, the field where my dad flew, Chuck's Donuts, and my personal favorite, which was the Saturday morning drive down Industrial Road, because over by the Circle Star Theater, there was a huge dip in the road. He'd say, "Hold on, Lizzie Bullets," and he'd press on the accelerator, gunning it for the big dip. I just knew we were gonna get all 4 tires off the ground one of those days. I loved to watch my dad build things. He spent many hours at his workbench in the garage, with the dog sleeping in his basket at my dad's feet. Dad had to be careful not to sneeze, or that dog would jump up and bite him in the ankles. I would go out into the garage and be totally amazed that he could turn a pile of balsa wood into a beautiful airplane. He would glue thousands of little pieces together to form the plane, then cover the entire frame with a plastic material that he would iron on with total perfection. The crowning glory was the installation of the pilot, who was the top half of whatever Barbie doll I had sacrificed for the cause. Those dolls flew many missions over Redwood City in my dad's planes. My dad was a great carpenter, and so he built larger things as well. Armed with the latest Sunset magazine, lumber, and a garage full of tools, he built structures like a beautiful arbor in our front yard and the most beautiful deck in our backyard on Oakhurst Avenue. That deck served as an oasis where years later, Mom and I would sit back and sip Chardonnay, listening to Charlie Bird and Wes Montgomery, while Dad painted our toenails and talked about the old days in Pittsburgh. Family vacations were the highlight of the summer. Stocked with a supply of penny candy from Peggy Lee's, my brothers and I would claim our spots in the back of the station wagon, and we would set out on our annual adventure. Mount Lassen, Yosemite, Disneyland, and Victoria, British Columbia were some of our destinations. It always started out joyfully, but inevitably, we would end up fighting in the back seat. Dad would, After warning us many times and threatening to pull over, Dad would eventually just reach back with one hand and start swinging at us. He never actually reached any of us because we could dodge out of his way on account of the fact that we didn't have seat belts. But Dad always got us safely to our destination. Our teenage years brought the usual rebellion, but my dad was always pretty cool about letting us learn our lessons the hard way. If we messed up, we had to own it and pay the consequence, which usually involved righting our wrong and being grounded. Thanksgivings were always my favorite family holiday. Along with the amazing meal that my mom always creates and cooks, carving the turkey was always Dad's job, the man's job. We would always try to snatch little pieces as they were being carved, and he would always tell us the story of the guy who stuck his hand in front of him when he was chopping with an axe. I think my dad nicked him with the axe and cut off part of his finger, but the story grew over the years. Dad, remember when you cut off that guy's arm with the axe? I'll miss hearing that story every year, though I suppose we will continue to reminisce about it. My dad taught us responsibility. He taught us the value of honesty and the importance of tradition. He taught us to respect our elders by addressing them as Mr. and Mrs. He taught us that you had to work for what you want. We always had chores and we always earned weekly allowance. But if you wanted something in particular, you had to save for it. My dad showed me what a gentleman is supposed to be like. He's one who pulls out your chair for you, opens the door for you, and waits for you to sit down before he sits down. He always treated women with respect. My dad often bought flowers for my mom from the flower stand near his office in San Francisco. He always went for walks with my mom after dinner. He was a great listener. My dad was a true gentleman. As a grandfather, my dad was the best. Our children loved everything about their grandpa. He would greet them with enthusiasm and tell them all kinds of stories of the past. He would get right down on the floor and play with them when they were little. He would let my daughter dress him up in silly outfits, and he'd play croquet and basketball and baseball and catch with my son. My dad came to every Halloween, Christmas, and Easter at our home. He attended countless birthday parties, block parties, pool parties, baseball games, basketball games, track meets, soccer games, softball games, dance recitals, and volleyball tournaments. He came to every school function at St. Charles that my children had. He came to spelling bees, science fairs, Christmas concerts, talent shows, and Special Persons Day. It was always fun to have my dad in attendance because everyone loved him. You couldn't help but love him. He was friendly, kind, and considerate. His big smile was so contagious, and when he laughed, you automatically just laughed along. My dad absolutely loved my husband. I viewed this as the ultimate seal of approval and complete assurance that Andy and I are meant to be together. In April of last year, when my parents came to San Diego for my dad's 80th birthday, Andy and Dad shared a magical day together. They took in a car show, ate at my dad's favorite place, and spent the day swapping stories. It means the world to me that they loved each other. Our most recent visit was a wonderful week over Christmas at our home in San Diego. We are so blessed to have had that week with my parents. My dad was so appreciative of everything. We enjoyed lunch at the Hotel Del Coronado, a walk on the beach, Christmas Day, including an epic Nerf gun war, visiting with our neighbors, cocktails by the ocean, and a wonderful day at the Air and Space Museum, where he acted as our own personal docent. He shared stories of his childhood and of his time in the armed forces. We hugged and we shared many I love yous. It was pure magic, and I am eternally grateful for that very special week that we had together. I recently went through hundreds of photographs and many, many letters and cards that my dad sent me through the years. Several times in those letters, he apologized for not always being a good father. I didn't understand why he said that because I cannot imagine having had a better father, and I told him that. As always, every time I see a small plane fly overhead, I am brought right back to my childhood, when no matter where you were or what you were doing, anytime a small plane from San Carlos Airport flew overhead, everything stopped. While my dad told us what kind of plane it was, what war it was in, what battles it fought in, why it had those particular wings, and the overall history of it. Now, when I look up at those planes, I will be looking beyond them as well, because I know that my dad is in heaven with my brother Gary and God. I miss you, Daddy.
My sorrow and pain. However, the thought that my father's had a full life and has been surrounded by family and friends that loved him gives me a feeling of peace inside. I will be missing him very much. There are places in my heart that I'll treasure forever. My father's love and strength, and places in my memory where remember his stories, his humor, his generosity, and his patience. I do recall some lessons that he did teach me. One time when I was, I'm sorry, I've got a little emotional towards Diane's. But when I was a teenager, a friend of mine, Randy, and I decided we were going to the high school dance, and we decided to drink a pint of Southern Comfort each within 15 minutes and then go to the dance. And everything was great. We were having fun dancing up a storm because I'm normally fairly shy. And then everything else was kind of moving around, and next thing you know, I was crawling on the floor and I had to be escorted out. And my dad and brother picked me up and brought me back to the house, and they were carrying me, you know, up the into through the front door, and my brother was saying, "Dad, you're really gonna punish him for that, aren't you? I mean, he really would." You know, and Dad just said, "When he wakes up tomorrow, that will be his punishment." So true. So true. Once again, he was correct. Anyway, I've been able to transfer some of these some of this wisdom to my son and family, which has been instilled by both of my parents. And, you know, Dad has taught many things to me. I think one of the most precious gifts was patience. Thanks to him, I learned how to be patient with people and myself and life in general. Also, he was able to instill upon me the ability of never getting lost in the small day-to-day problems and concentrate on your big picture and main goals. You know, I love that my father and I had shared some wonderful memories together that will keep close to my heart. In a way, for me, I feel like he's never left, and he will always be here in my heart, which is where he belongs. Thank you very much.
Today, my name is Luca Pusateri Gissendaner, and I am the grandson of George Gissendaner. My grandfather was a great man who was honest and very trustworthy. I hold a lot of memories of him, which I will always treasure in my heart. Now today, I'm going to tell the most exciting times I had with my grandfather. Once, Grandma and Grandpa were coming to our boat in Sausalito, California. I was only 9 years old then, and my father just taught me how to drive a 22-foot boat with a 225-horsepower motor. That was a big deal. When Grandma and Grandpa came, I invited them on a boat ride. Grandma didn't want to come because she thought she was going to get her hair messy. But Grandpa said, "Let's go, grandson," and off we went. We cruised around Sausalito waterfront. We saw seals, houseboats, and the Corps of Engineers dock. When we were coming in, Grandma was waving to us on the way in. Grandpa loved it, and so did I, because this made me feel that he could trust me for such a big thing. That was the biggest gift he ever gave me. Another time was in his garage, and there were planes, tools, all kinds of super really cool stuff. I loved him in there. And so whenever I see a plane flying in the sky, it reminds me of him and how much I love him. I do not know what the last words Grandpa said to you, but the final last words Grandpa said to me were, "Goodbye, Luca. I love you very much." Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Luca. How old are you, man? 9. Oh, Tim. Yeah, he just went up one. Okay, good. Good job, man. All right. Well, we want to open it up to any of the rest of the family. Any of the other family want to come before we open it up to the friends as well? Okay. We'll just open it up to any of you. And if you'd be willing to come, give us your name and how you are related to George and a brief memory, we would welcome that now. We have just a few of you who do that. Yes, ma'am. Come.
My name is Frances Stone, and Paul, my husband, and I were invited over to dinner at George and Joni's. I know Joni from Curves, as a Curves coach, and we went over and met them and had a lovely evening, and Joni has reflected the Lord Jesus Christ to me all along, and it was just nice to see the whole picture, to have George reflect that also. We had a delightful evening, and we are really privileged to have met George this side of heaven. So when we join him, we will all be joyful.
My name is Tim Saito, and I've got to know George and Joni through Sunday school, as well as what I'll be reading here. George quickly made a positive impression on the many people he met at Valley Community Church. George described himself as still being early in his growth as a Christian, so he was serious about growing to be more like Jesus. George was a vibrant member of the Saturday morning Ministry to Men's class to transition from good to great in God's eyes. George's last Saturday morning was spent with us as we learned to look back at people who were monumental in our life. Pastor Chip Ingram, the author and speaker on our video series, urged us to look back to see who was on our personal Mount Rushmore as a major positive influence. The class was asked, "Who is on your Mount Rushmore?" Here's a reply that Ed Liu sent. "I also was shocked to hear of George's passing yesterday. As many of you remember, George shared how his wife Joni is on his Mount Rushmore since she was monumental in bringing him to the Lord. They had a remarkable life story of separation, healing, and reconciliation. And I rest in the comfort that he knew our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Praying for Joni and their family, Ed Liu."
Thank you, sir.
My name is Roberto Gonzalez. I attended Fremont Community Church, where George was a member for many years. Doug, when he talked this morning, was a member leader of our men's group where George was. It's one thing to have a friend. It's another thing to have a brother like George. George spoke a lot after our Saturday mornings. He loved Joni, loved the family. I always talked about Sausalito in San Diego. And we used to meet at Denny's because we liked to eat, have our Bible study. We switched to Hometown Buffet because we liked to eat. But George would always be eat healthy. He'd always make sure that, you know, he didn't have a lot of the starches. He would ask for fruit. And evidently, every time they brought him fruit, they would bring him grapes. So one time they brought the fruit, hey, George, because I know grapes. Are they going to go, oh yeah, it was good. We started another book today that Doug brought to us. And I got to a chapter this morning, and Doug said it was very fitting that we would read that today. I didn't know that the theme today would be about David, but I'd like to read this to you and what the book says, and I can almost hear George saying these words to all of you. If you're not involved in a Bible study with men or women, I encourage you to really do that. And George is a friend and a brother to me that meant a lot. His smiles, the way he came across, and it was wonderful. It says, when King David was about to die, he laid down his own list of things he wanted his son Solomon to have nailed down. Now the days of David drew near that he should die. And he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth. Be strong, therefore, and prove yourself a man. And keep the charge of the Lord your God to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes, his commandments, his judgments, and his testimonies. As it is written in the law of Moses, that you may prosper in all that you do, and whatever you turn. I just felt George saying these words to me this morning. The last thing I want to leave you with is this woman right here. After my community church, we have a time of prayer at the end of the services. And I've always seen her up there. She has prayed for us and our family and my son especially, and I can't thank you enough for that. A very godly woman, I hope that you all cherish what this lady and man brought to this church. God bless all of you. God bless you, George. I will miss you, brother.
All right, anyone else? Okay, we have, one more? Okay.
Okay. My name is Julie, and I am a dear friend to Joni and to George. I know a lot about her family. I know a lot about her grandchildren. But I want to publicly give Joni and George thanks through my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as well for at least 15 years of faithfully praying for me and my family. It was offered as a birthday gift. She said, I will give you 1 year of prayer. And she did. And then she added all my family, lovable people, but broken and desperately needing a savior. And somebody that would intercede. And to this day, she continues to pray for my family, who is much stronger, reconciled to each other, to the Lord Jesus Christ as well. And it is because of the love and the support and the power of prayer and in the promise that God is for us and not against us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
to the conclusion of our time here in the auditorium, we want you to know that you are all invited to a reception that will follow immediately after the benediction. You go out these doors and down out of the lobby, outdoors, and immediately take a left down that hall there. There are steps upstairs as well as elevator to the reception hall, and you're almost welcome to be there. Closing scripture I leave you with is Romans 8, 37 to 39. No matter what comes, we will always taste victory through God who loves us. For nothing, not death, not life, not heavenly messengers, dark spirits, the present, the future, spiritual powers, height, depth, nor any creature can come between us and the love of God that's revealed in Jesus Christ. And now to God the Father, who can do so many awe-inspiring things, immeasurable things, things greater than we ever could ask or imagine through the power of the Holy Spirit who is at work within us. To him be all glory in the Church of Jesus Christ from this generation to the next, forever and ever. Amen.